Hello and welcome to the marketplace. This is the Friday's edition. Here we analyze the market, we talk about trends and investment and how global development is impacting business activity here in Ghana and in your businesses across the countries and beyond. In our bulletin today, Finance Minister Seth Ekpe to present to Parliament supplementary and mid-year review budget next Monday. We'll be looking at that in detail here. And also, cement company Dangote expecting to complete the construction of a $100 million cement grinding plant in Takoradi to make Ghana a leader in cement production. And also, government continuous borrowing threaten SMEs access to financing here in Ghana. All these and more we have here as a package for you on the marketplace. So you can stay interactive with us on Twitter. Our handle is JoyBusinessGH, and on Facebook it says Joy Business. For more business stories, you can also log on to myjoyonline.com/business. My name is John Kojo Amoko. Please stay, and marketplace returns shortly after the break. Welcome back. And in our first story, Finance Minister Seth Ekpe is expected to present to Parliament a supplementary and mid-year review budget next Monday. George Raffi has been finding out more about some of the areas that the budget may touch and as to why the presentation on this particular time by the Minister of Finance.
The presentation has come about as a result of some challenges in meeting most of the macroeconomic targets set out in the 2016 budget. Government was, for instance, looking at an economic growth of 5.4%, end-of-year inflation target of about 10.1%, and a fiscal deficit target of 5.3%. It was also looking at a revenue target of 38 billion Ghana cedis, while his expenditure, he was looking at about 43 billion Ghana cedis. The benchmark price of oil revenue, which was also pegged at $53 a barrel, will be reviewed. However, Joy Business is learning that most of these targets will be revised, especially when it comes to the economic growth, which might be reviewed down to about 3.9%, as well as the deficit. The finance minister also announced revenue and expenditure numbers for the first half of 2016 and expected fiscal numbers for the rest of the year. He will also be seeking parliamentary approval to spend additional funds that have come in, what some will call the supplementary budget. Joy Business is learning that the finance minister wants approval to spend some monies that have come in from the energy sector levy, which is expected to be advanced towards addressing the legacy debts in the energy sector, which was threatening the existence of some commercial banks. But will this presentation help convince investors that government is on track in stabilizing the economy as well as dealing with the overruns? Dr. Joe Abe is an economist.
I think it will take more than words. It will take a backup in terms of more explanation, because you can go and say all manner of nice things today, but where, unfortunately, the government of the day must understand is that there is a question about why should I believe what you tell me. I'm sorry, but with so many years in public life, I get news items and I cannot understand what is happening.
Many also will be looking forward to see whether government may come up with some additional measures to check its rising expenditure, especially in an election year.
Now, let's now go on the phone lines, where we have an economist and a chartered accountant and also a lecturer at the Kumasi Polytechnic, Thomas Kisibuafo, to tell us what exactly and what to expect in this mid-year review, budget review. Mr. Kisibuafo, you're welcome to the marketplace.
Thank you very much.
Good. It was meant for today, but for one or two reasons, it has been postponed to Monday. The Minister of Finance will be in Parliament to actually tell Ghanaians what exactly the state of the economy is, and then the target as set by themselves, and also to have probably asked for some more money from Ghanaians. What are we to expect in the first place, and what does this mean for the economy?
Well, good afternoon to your cherished viewers. What we should expect is the fact that, when you look at the current trends, you see the commodity, especially our major export commodity, cocoa is picking up gradually, only that the oil situation is where we still have a problem. This means that expect our revenue situation at least to be coming down, because I do not expect anything picking up seriously from the area of the oil. And when we also look at our cocoa, I don't expect any significant improvement in the cocoa output. We have already closed the year and we're just about to start a new crop season. So we don't expect anything to come out from that area. Gold is picking up as we all expected. So we expect a downward trend in terms of our revenue. And when we look at the aspect of transition, you see, the economy did not pick up seriously. When you look at the composite index of business activities, it's not as robust used to be in the previous first half of the previous year.
Exactly.
This means that we will not be able to do much by way of revenue collection. Most of the businesses are crying. Then again, the return of the subsidy that has been classified as realignment is also another thing that we should be able to look at. It's at the next year, the government will need to clear so many arrears. We also heard about the reintroduction of the restoration of the allowances of nurses.
Exactly.
And this means that the government will have to cough more if the teachers also push further.
But I'm sure we're going to come to that in a jiffy. But then, because somebody would ask, where are they getting the money from? Because the last time I checked, they did not budget for this particular allowance reintroduction. So we'll be looking at that in detail here on the market. But Banan, you started with some of the target. Now, let's start from the growth rate. Somewhere around 2015 December, when the budget was being presented in Parliament, the minister made it known or made all Ghanaians aware that they are expecting a growth rate of about 5.4%. But currently, according to some sources, we are hovering around 4%, almost about a 100 percentage point decline, or outside the target, or some, as the accountant would say, variance. Basically, what do you think is accounting for this? Let's just go through them one after the other, especially the growth target, the inflation target, the fiscal deficit target, and also revenue and expenditure target here in Ghana.
Yeah, well, in terms of growth, we were expecting, after several promises, we were all thinking that the energy situation will be better. But it looks as if the energy situation is now deteriorating. And it is not giving us the hope that the problem will be solved anytime soon. This has accounted for the decline. Then again, when you look also at the situation where the interest rate, we were all expecting that after the
central bank, the monetary policies and stuff.
The monetary policy, we were expecting the interest rate to be coming down. But when you look at it, it looks as if the interest rate is going up. It means that business activities, business are not expanding the way as it is. And then the rain also, we cannot, the rainfall is not at its best. So this year, is also not going to be the best as we are all expecting. And then when you look at the manufacturing sector, they are also crying. They can't expand. The businesses are being taken away from them. People are contracting Chinese to do their manufacturing for them here and there. So generally, one can say that the economy did not pick the needed momentum. Confidence is still down. When you look at the performance of the composite index of Ghana stock market, you realize that it is still negative.
Exactly.
It tells you that the business is not doing well as expected, manufacturing not doing well, agri not doing well, all boiled down to the energy situation. All boiled down. And then also taxes. A number of taxes have discouraged so many people, you know, for various activities. Most of them are returning their working capital that could be used for expansion, you know, to pay taxes. Some of them are being forced to clear arrears, tax arrears from previous years.
Mr. Kisibwafoy, the government will tell you they need money to prosecute development agenda here in Ghana, so the growth and expansion required of the economy will be achieved. I don't think that is wrong fundamentally. You are a chartered accountant, and economists are that.
Yeah. I understand it, but see, when you collect taxes, it is just like feeding an animal. As you feed the cow, then you milk the cow. You can't milk the cow without properly feeding the cow. The environment is not very good. Mm. Then you continue to suck the milk. It will create a lot of problems.
Okay.
The reason is the taxes are good anyway, but the question then is, where do we channel the taxes? Okay. Mainly for consumption, interest payment, debt repayment, and then for wages and salaries.
Okay, let's look at another critical target that they set for themselves last year, which is very critical for me and then you, for example, which is inflation. A target of about 10.1% was set, but as we speak, inflation is hovering around 18.4%. That's almost about 8.4%, if you ask me, as the variance or the difference between the target and what is exactly happening today. What is also accounting for this, Mr. Kisibwafoy?
Well, the inflation, most of them caused by power fraud. When you look even at food, one expect to see that the food situation should have given us a lot of problems, but it looks as if the food inflation is not very much compared to others like tariffs. So the inflation is as a result of the pass-through effect of increases in tariffs, especially imposition of taxes on petroleum, imposition of taxes on other things like electricity and out of water. When you look at situations like this, then you expect inflation to be picking up. Mm. Also, banks are borrowing at higher interest rate,
okay,
and then there will also be a pass-through effect in terms of manufacturing. So when you look at Ghana, item manufactured here, that is local inflation coming from manufactured items, are higher than the imported inflation, if you look at the dynamic.
Mm.
So it is becoming very expensive to produce in Ghana,
okay,
as a result of the fact that all the inputs are attracting taxes.
Okay, Mr. Bofo, let's maybe as we close, let's look at this. Tech will be in Parliament on Monday to probably be asking for more money from Ghanaians so they can actually continue with their work as the management of the economy. Now, we have almost a deficit of about $1 billion to serve or to service. Now, it's going to ask for more money. Would it be justified to ask for more money from Ghanaians?
Well, what I can say is that looking at the situation, the money will come from where? The only place that the money will be coming from is that of the Bank of Ghana deficit financing. And that will be a printing press that will also put further pressure on the currency. Yesterday, we had Parliament, approving 5% ceiling to the borrowing by the government from the central bank.
Mm.
IMF limiting it to 0% borrowing. And I don't know what will ensue between government and that of the IMF. But whatever be the case, if that is the approach the government is going to use, then the end of the higher inflation and that of higher interest rates, the end of it is not in sight.
Because I'm sure by the end of this particular year, they're going to go for some euro bond of about $1 billion here to refinance existing debt and also use part to sort of like do some other development project. And also, we do also know for a fact that they will be coming out with some domestic bonds as well to refinance maturing debt here in Ghana. Is it not going to increase our debt to GDP ratio, which some economists are saying very detrimental to our development?
And that is true. You see, we've reached a very vulnerable position, especially when the structure of our debt is dollar pivot. When you have a structure, when your structure of your debt is dollar pivot, with about 60% of your total debt is dollar denominated, there will be serious pressure on you. It means that in future, we need to generate more foreign currencies, in order to pay for interest and that of the settlement of the principal amount. This means that there will be a lot of pressure on your currency. And as it is, economy that we are still struggling as to how we position local businesses, which will serve as a credible alternative when it comes to producing substitute goods that we use to import, that the end is also not in sight. I will emphasize that in future, with this trend of borrowing, I think we are going to find it very, very difficult. And each borrowing is attracting higher interest. That is where our problem is, because of the extent of our how we have been downgraded. If you look at the bond market or the euro bond, when you go there, Ghana is attracting the highest interest burden.
Okay,
and this is also very dangerous for this region. Okay. What we can, my advice is that the borrowing you said to be for the repayment of already mature debt. My problem is that we should be able to succeed borrowing long term. Now, some countries have started 100 years, 50 years, 20 years, and as our debt sustainability index deteriorates, I don't think we'll be able to enjoy in
Okay, Mr. Kisuba, I think we're going to end it here for time. We're going to come back to explore this subject further before the minister gets to parliament to deliver that particular statement. We'll be coming to you again for details from him. That was Mr. Kisi Buafo, who is a lecturer at the Kumasi Polytechnic and also a chartered accountant and an economist, bringing us to speed on what is happening and giving us some perspective on the impact of this particular review and supplementary budget on the economy of Ghana. Now, moving on here in on the marketplace, cement company Dangote is expected to complete the construction of its $100 million cement grinding plant in Takra, the latest by March 2018. Aside from creating jobs in the economy, the initiative is also expected to propel Ghana to join Nigeria as a major supplier of cement in the sub-region. The company has been distributing cement in the country in the past 6 years. Etonam Komla Buami is the media relations manager of Dangote Cement.
In Takoradi, we are investing $100 million US dollars in the Takoradi plant. Work is already in progress. We're hoping that towards the end of next year, we should be commissioning the Takoradi factory. At worst, first quarter of 2018, Takoradi plant should be on board. That is going to be a state-of-the-art cement manufacturing plant. Aside we producing cement for the Ghanaian market, we want to transport it to other neighboring countries, and we're also hoping that that will be more like a tourist site, because it will be a magnificent building that everybody would love to see and to even use the product that comes from there. So we're going to grind, we're going to do everything that any other cement manufacturing company would do in a typical cement production system. So we're going to follow all the chains of grinding, bagging, everything will be done at that particular plant. It's not just about expansion we are doing. Our focus is investing heavily in the economy of Ghana. If the Tema terminal, for example, is employing close to 5,000 people, direct and indirect, if a fully fledged factory comes on board in Takoradi, you can imagine the number of jobs it's going to create. And so that is heavy investment we are doing into the Ghanaian economy. And so everybody is excited that, hey, Dangote is giving about 5,000 jobs. And we can increase it as 2 times 3 if the Takoradi comes on board. As we speak now, before the trust came on board, we have local staff of 700. But by next week, additional 500 are going to draw their salary from our payroll, because already 500 drivers have received their appointment letter effective 1st July. We're hoping that within the next 2 weeks, the rest 500 would also have received their appointment letter. And it's not just about drivers we are going to recruit within a short term, because 1,000 drivers cannot be managed by one person. So it means our fleet department needs to be expanded, our marketing department needs to be expanded, human resources need to be expanded. And so it's going to be lots of job between now and the end of year for Ghanaians to benefit from.
Now, government's continuous borrowing is threatening SMEs' access to financing. Several issues have been identified to be undermining the ability of the SMEs to attract financing from the banks. Speaking to Joy Business ahead of the Ishmael Yamson and Associates Executive Business Roundtable discussion, CEO of Ishmael Yamson and Associate Raymond Acker indicated that banks prefer investing in bonds rather than issuing loans to SMEs as a result of certainty and security concerns. The meeting will be held under the theme "Staying Viable and Profitable in Our Current Difficult Times."
Economic developments in the country has caused most businesses to be operating under very difficult conditions. Though much of the challenges are attributed to macroeconomic conditions, some are attributed to internal factors of the organization. the senior partner and chief operations officer of Ishmael Yamson and Associates, Michael Yamson, shares some of these internal factors.
So now let me talk about five challenges that we believe arise from the decisions that entrepreneurs make. The first is the challenge of low technology. There is a tendency to buy the cheapest technology, but inherent in that low technology choice is a high operating cost. So we need to think hard about our technology choices as business owners. The second thing is the resilience of our businesses. We tend to say start small, and small is beautiful. But when you start so small that you don't even have the operating capital to keep the business going, then you introduce a certain fragility into the business. That means that you are unable to deal with even the smallest shocks. The third thing is the businesses are fragmented. So that integrated thinking across an industry doesn't happen. So everybody is fragmented. That's also an internal choice. The fourth thing is the kind of people we pick. We tend to pick the lowest cost person. And we don't tend to train that person. What happens is that you constrain your business in terms of its ability to generate innovation, to generate original thought, to generate exciting new concepts that will bring new business.
A key issue identified by many SMEs is accessing credit. The major reason for this challenge has been the increasing cost of credit. However, speaking to Joy Business, the Chief Executive Officer of Ishmael Yamson & Associates, Raymond Aka, attributed the credit constraint to government's persistent borrowing.
When we talk to a lot of small and medium-sized organizations and this discussion about finance being difficult to access or very expensive even when you access it, the one side of it is all the policy issues. We know, for example, that government is borrowing quite heavily domestically. So what that means is that if I'm a bank and the government is willing to pay whatever interest rate is paying now for me to give it money, then if I'm then sitting between government and Kwame Atta Enterprise, I probably may judge government as a lesser risk than Kwame Atta Enterprise. And therefore, that space within which we all borrow becomes crowded. And when it becomes crowded, then even if Kwame Atta Enterprises eventually accesses the finance, the cost of that money is pretty high. And therefore, it makes it very difficult if you haven't got all the collaterals and the things that surround accessing the access, then accessing the finance, then it becomes very difficult. And if you do, it's very expensive.
You're welcome back. And government has been advised to look for complementary sources of raising revenue to finance development projects in the country. Alternative sources such as remittances, public-private partnerships, and funds generated from curtailing illicit financial flows were suggested. Latest reports indicate that Ghana's debt has crossed the $100 billion mark and continues to grow. This came up at the launch of the UN Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, Economic Development in Africa report in Accra. Business agenda now, actually let us have some repeat of it on here on the market. We'll be looking at that in detail as well. So let's have it.
According to a report on economic development in Africa, remittances and diaspora bonds contributed to $63.8 billion as at 2014, whereas illicit financial flows as at 2008 amounted to $854 billion. Speaking to Joy Business at the launch of the 2016 Economic Development in Africa report, managing partner at SICADA, Philip A. Kobner said encouraging formal remittance channels and curtailing illicit financial flows could complement development revenues.
The illicit financial flows, we ought to work at our tax administration, our customs regulations, GRA, and then its sister companies, to ensure that appropriate and right prices are given for goods coming in and then going out, to the extent that the tax revenues that ought to accrue to us are the exact tax revenues that we got. Because it's very scary, the numbers that we saw, 854 billion over a certain 20-year period of money is going out of our economies. And then what is even more scary is that one third of that amount of money for the same period could have catered to all the development and the external debt of African countries. That's about 279 billion out of the 854 billion could have catered to the external debt of African countries. It means that if we're able to work at this outflow of illicit finances, chances are we might not be as dependent on our development partners as we have been in the past.
The program leader of the World Bank Group, Errol George Graham, was also of the opinion that encouraging private-public partnerships could also inure positively to this agenda.
Well, public-private partnership, I think, holds tremendous opportunities for Ghana, and I'm aware that the government is already moving in that direction through the establishment of the Ghana Infrastructure Investment Fund, for example, establish a framework for public-private sector partnership, and I think that holds considerable promise.
The Economic Development in Africa report analyzes various aspects concerning Africa's development, economic and policy affairs of key interest to various African countries.
So on that note, we end today's edition of The Marketplace. My name is John Kojo Amwaku, but you can stay interactive with us if you want to. Our Twitter handle is JoyBusinessGH, and on Facebook, it is JoyBusiness. For more business stories, you can log on to myjoyonline.com/business. Have a very wonderful weekend as we wait to meet all of you again Monday.